Namaskar and welcome to this edition of Insight. I am Charu Karthikeya. Today we will be talking about the 50th anniversary celebrations of the African Union. The African Union essentially was born out of the Organization of African Unity that was established in 1963. It evolved into the African Union in 2002 at the African Union Summit that was held in the capital of Ethiopia, Addis Ababa, where the OAA, where the Organization of African Unity was founded 50 years back. We'll be talking about what were the messages that were sent out from the summit, and especially we'll be talking about India's relationship with the African world. So all of that and much more in this edition of Insight. Joining us in the studio today is a fantastic panel of experts. We have with us today Dr. Sriram Cholia, Professor and Dean, Jindal School of Global Health. Dr. Cholia, thank you so much for coming here. That essentially is the dilemma that analysts must be faced with, Dr. Cholia. As Kalol said, number of crises breaking out in various parts of the continent, and yet you have pockets of growth, rather very very fast growth, rapid growth, and growth that is really giving some sort of a competition to the other growing economies of the world. How are you looking at the concept of Pan-Africanism in the last 50 years?
Relatively speaking, these crises have lessened compared to the Cold War era.
Okay.
Definitely, the wars are less brutal and less widespread than they were during the Cold War era.
Hmm.
So I think, and the other issue, as you mentioned, is the democratic surplus that's gradually accumulating in Africa. I mean, 32 out of the 54 member states have proper elected governments, and if you just look at it statistically, it's a lot better than it was before. And the AU institutions must take credit, because if you remember, the African Union Charter was a big break away from the earlier Organization of African Unity in terms of emphasizing representative government and opposing military coups.
Right.
So 2010, there was a coup in Niger. Immediately, it was expelled from the African Union. 2012, Guinea-Bissau, military coup, immediately expelled. So they have actually come a long way, even ideationally, as to what it means to be united. Because earlier, it was united against colonialism and against neocolonialism and the plunder of natural wealth. And over time, what that idea has now, I think, mushroomed to the point where they're talking about we need to be united against unacceptable forms of violence and state power that leads to impunity. So military coups are total no-no. You hardly have any on the African continent today. So that's, again, all credit to the Union. The other thing, you know, the Union has done is to try and create a kind of a people's unity apart from the unity of the state elites, because that's one big difference. Because the state elites have continued to play narrow agendas in some of these countries, which is the cause for some of the crises you're mentioning. You know, tribalism, playing on ethnicities, inciting people to violence, and so on. But the Union's concept has always been to counter these bigoted forms of identity, create a broader self-identity for the people of Africa. And certainly, the Union has been successful in that. I just want to quote my Pan-African teacher, Horace Campbell. He says, every pan concept, as in like pan-African, every pan concept is an exercise in self-definition by a people, aimed at establishing a broader redefinition of themselves than what had so far been permitted by those in power.
Okay.
So the broader redefinition of the African self, I think that's one of the grand achievements of the African Union. Because every time somebody says, you know, narrow nationalism, you cannot cross borders, this is a nation state, the people have been asking, you know, we don't accept these artificial boundaries. People want free movement. I mean, I'm reminded of the great Nigerian Pan-African thinker, Tajuddin Abdul Rahim, who once told Mele Zenawi, the Ethiopian strongman, said, Ethiopia is not your garden. Why are you not? And Ethiopia is the headquarters of the African Union, right? It's the political center of the African Union. Why are you not allowing our people to move? So there is a popular understanding of African Union and one of the state elites. And often the disjuncture between the two has led to ruin. But I hope that, you know, the greater now you have institutions like the Pan-African Parliament. This is a great achievement. This is now into its third term, which is elected by legislators from individual countries, not yet directly elected by African people. But once you have a Pan-African Parliament, you know, it is deepening the notion of democracy and unity across the continent.
Okay.
So I think we have come a long way.
Okay. No, but the essential question is, how effective is the Union proving to be as far as giving a leadership, as far as giving a whole direction of unity to the continent is concerned? Dr. Cholia, the AU face this criticism of sitting quietly, not interfering at an early juncture as far as Libya is concerned, then later also in Mali. At the point where various kinds of crises are breaking out across the continent, the EU has been criticized for not interfering early enough. What does that say about the EU's leadership?
Sir, they have an early warning continent-wide early warning system within the EU framework to prevent conflicts. But what is happening is there's a lot of this continued external meddling. Mm. There's no doubt about it.
Yeah.
And that has often, in the past, it was really, really blatant in the name of containing communism and all that.
Mm.
But of late, what has happened is, you have situations in the name of these humanitarian interventions, supposedly to prevent genocide or crimes against humanity.
Mm.
And the EU has the potential to field its own rapid deployment force and so on.
Right.
But what happens often is that the regions have been carved out by these former colonial actors. So there is a so-called Francophonie zone.
Mm.
Right.
Hmm.
So what does the government of Mali do when they have a Islamist insurgency? Do they call France? For they don't call Nigeria.
Right.
Which is supposed to be the leader of the region of West Africa.
So can't the African Union do anything at that point of time
to
encourage more intra-African cooperation than banking on external forces?
This has been the perennial problem right from the days of Kwame Nkrumah and the great founding father of the African Pan-African movement.
Hmm.
They have always been wary about the divide and rule strategy.
Hmm.
So, Kwame Nkrumah used to say, if we allow ourselves to be Balkanized, we will be recolonized.
Mm-hmm.
And, they'll pick us off one after the other because we have so much natural wealth and the external great powers want it.
Hmm.
So the AU has been trying to forge consensus. But what often happens is it's overridden by some of these state elites or guerrilla movements which have their own agendas. I mean, look at the war in the Democratic Republic of Congo.
Hmm.
It's one of the, I would say, the AU must accept that it's a failure for the
Absolutely.
AU. It has not been able to prevent it.
Absolutely.
11 to 12 countries have been sending their armies to try and plunder the Congo, which is one of the world's richest countries, and all neighboring countries.
Mm.
So Rwanda, Uganda, all of them have, proxies fighting in the Congo in order to loot its natural wealth.
Mm.
So this is where we need, some kind of supranational institutional framework to prevent this kind. The other one, of course, has been issues like Zimbabwe, where there is a strong man who is not willing to give up power, but there is a kind of a closing of ranks around him by his Pan-African comrades from the liberation struggle era.
Mm.
So some of these people have outlived Museveni in Uganda. These people have been ruling 20, 25, 30 years now, and they continue to parrot the line of the African Union, but they're actually undermining the core values and the norms of the African Union. So there are a lot of normative growth in the African Union. It's much more advanced than our region, for example. We have no sub-regional mechanisms for human rights. We don't have a court for human rights and people's issues. We don't have our own regional parliament, nothing, right?
Mm.
So in that sense, it's much more advanced. Mm. But what happens is they often get divided by external intervention. Now, the big latest thing they're saying is we want total financial self-reliance for the African Union institutions.
Mm.
Right now, they're dependent on donors.
Mm.
More than 50% of the funding for the institutions are coming from China, European Union and the US.
Yeah.
So how will they be able to overcome this? This can only come from some kind of revolutionary fervor from within the societies where people say, we're not going to accept the old kind of politics which was based on looking up to France or asking Britain or United States or even China to come to our rescue. So that's where in India, for example, we are much more democratic in our exchanges there.
Right.
We are not trying to go and dictate terms.
Right.
So this is where, I think people welcome us much more and we can make a real contribution towards democratizing the AU structures.
Right. Dr. Cholia, your assessment of India's approach towards Africa.
I think we have done in our own trademark way, small and meaningful things that may not add up to a massive presence there like the Chinese have, but it's still, I would say, relatively well thought out and more people oriented and more grassroots centered. But I think we also need to appreciate the AU's position that there is still this whole colonial approach of trying to dig the minerals and run away with them. So that, you know, India is not in that business. And that's where we stand apart from many other powers. And if you think about it, the Ethiopian foreign minister was saying, you know, Africa is the new El Dorado, where there's a gold rush and, you know, people are just trooping in. The Chinese, of course, the most prominent new entrants, but there are also older players there. So I think we have to be cognizant always about, I think we are much more sensitive to, not only to the state elites, but to people's, I mean, Jindal Group, for example, has mining in Mozambique and elsewhere, in Zimbabwe, I think. So here, you know, when we are into extractive industries, it's absolutely essential that we respect the local sensitivities. You know, it's the same mantra that our corporations are often accused of failing to adhere to within our country when it comes to land. There's also a huge concern among African people and Pan-Africanists and at the AU level about all these massive tracts of agricultural land that are being taken over for private farming by foreign countries. So again, there is, you know, we have not seen, it's like terra nullius, you know, that's the image of the colonialists, that Africa is there for, you know, for taking. We don't care about the people. So that's where I think
there have been some similar allegations against Indian businessmen too, who have been there and who have sort of disturbed the balance of nature. Various, for example, some newspapers have been writing about various sugar mills there, various dam projects there, embankments where the courses of rivers have been disturbed by artificial banks, and those have been done by essentially by businessmen, but rivers have come around and the result have been mass flooding of villages.
Yeah, but those projects I would still say are smaller in scale than the larger infrastructural projects that, for example, the Chinese do, and which have greater potential damage. But, you know, we must do social audits, environmental audits, and coordinate with the African Union better. Because sometimes what happens is that these projects we do are negotiated with host governments only of individual African countries. But sometimes their vision of African development clashes with that of the AU and the Pan-African level. So I think we must also coordinate with the, and you know, at the end of the day, it's always a fact that African countries, if they're united in terms of having a code of conduct and a charter with which to allow foreign corporations to come in, they will be much stronger than if they do it one-on-one with China or even with India for that matter. So we must be building those capacities. The other big element I wanted to mention where India should do a lot is with regard to youth empowerment. I mean, the median age in Africa is 19 to 20 years. We often boast that, you know, India is a young country and we have a demographic dividend. Africa has an even better future in the longer term. So when the AU talks about 2063, which is another 50 years, they're looking at the maturation of this demographic dividend, which should, you know, lead them to middle income status. So that's where, you know, we will need
and
to do a lot.
They probably have a natural affinity towards India because we see a very large number of young Africans coming to India every year for studying.
For education. Also, there are very interesting projects like, for example, the Barefoot College has done these solar electricity projects involving grandmothers as well as younger people. So there's a lot that we can do in a meaningful way. It may not all add up to domination, but perhaps we should not be looking at that or even competition. No, we should be looking at doing something which will be appreciated by the people there, which wins us goodwill. In the long run, you know, we have suffered from some degree of underinvestment in the past. African countries have not unanimously backed us when we bid for the permanent membership of the Security Council. So these are the kind of things, you know, eventually you do good and don't expect anything in return, it will come back.
Okay. What does the future of the African Union look like to you?
It's a bright one because the flame that was lit 50 years ago was based on a kind of wide-ranging continental solidarity. And remember, African Pan-Africanism and the African Union were not just about uniting the continent, but it's also about a global quest for peace and justice. So they were integrated with the Caribbean, they integrated with the people of African origin in Latin America, and of course, Asian African solidarity, which was so central, because if you remember, the stalwarts of the African of the OAU project were also involved in the Bandung conference, and there was a direct flow between all these thoughts. So in the sense that it has been an alliance of the formerly oppressed, I think the flame is still bright, because Africa remains in human development indices despite the economic growth that we're talking about, at the bottom, sub-Saharan Africa especially. And we share a lot with them, in the sense that, you know, if you look at absolute poverty levels, South Asia is another big cluster, along with sub-Saharan Africa. So we are on similar level in some ways. If you travel into the interior parts of Africa, into the villages, you find very similar problems. The nearest health center is 15 kilometers away, and people have no conveyance. You know, there's no electricity. Those sort of issues are common. So I think the fight will go on, but it's a multi-layered fight now. It's not only against foreign powers and Western imperialism, or Chinese for that matter. It's about how we can create a new kind of South-South cooperation and consensus, which will lead to transcontinental unity of the oppressed people. And this is, I think, the ultimate contribution of the African Union to world history. Because people will, of course, we have already pointed out many flaws in its structure and organization and its in implementation of its normative agenda and so on. And those will remain. But what, you know, at the macro level, because we are looking at a 50 years and what's going to come up next, you know, we must always remember that this was, as Kwame Nkrumah used to say, you know, we don't have the arms or the material might. What we have is a kind of a moral and spiritual power, and that they have harnessed. And now, in the concrete terms, in diplomatic terms, if we engage in South-South cooperation, strengthen Addis, the institutions in the African Union headquarters, and you know, build our diplomacy in a way where every action we take individually with African states is also coordinated at the union level. That will be a massive contribution, and I think that's all. That's the future.
Okay.
You know, the Pan-African Parliament says our resources should not leave the continent before some value is added to them.
Okay.
So from primary export of primary commodities to its own industrializations, small and medium enterprises, India has a role.
Okay. Dr. Cholia, very quickly, your take on that.
I think, you know, the supranational entities need to evolve, and they need to have traction at the grassroots, at the local level. So supranational and local, once they are in tandem and in sync with each other, I think the sovereignty problems and the narrow nationalism and the divisions will vanish, and Africa will be much more united, much more like the European Union.
How far is that day?
I think it will take, you know, a couple of decades, no longer, because see, when you're talking about the demographic dividend maturing, a lot of these young people are boundaryless. You know, they just want to cross, and they just don't accept the visa regimes, and, you know, the police pushing them back and all. So there's going to be a revolt across the continent as these people mature. Tunisia and Egypt are the, you know, canaries in the wharf to what is going to come. You know, they're going to, it's a signal to all the elites, you know, across the continent, to beware of their own people and not to take them for granted. And that is ultimately the message of Pan-Africanism.
Okay. Dr. Sriram Cholia, thank you so much for your time.
Thank you.
That's all we have for you in this edition of Insight. Thank you so much for watching us, and do stay tuned to Lok Sabha Television for more. Namaskar.